I'm David Bailey. I'm Creative Director of User Experience Design at the BBC. And I'm going to talk to you today about the way that our department is structured at the BBC and how the work, about our work as well, and how we're helping the BBC to transform from being a traditional broadcaster to becoming an internet-fit public service. But before I do that, I thought I'd show you some pictures of where I work. Because I often go to these things and watch speakers on stage, and I always wonder about actually what their context is, what their surroundings are, where their designers work. Plus, the BBC has some really great and cool buildings, so I thought I'd show you some pictures of that, if you don't mind. So this is New Broadcasting House. This is literally next door in Portland Place. This is one of the BBC's buildings in London. It's the home of the famous BBC newsroom, which is a vital and heavy and busy place and full of incredibly talented journalists and engineers and all sorts of great people. This is a really intense environment, but exciting. Up in the north in Manchester, just outside Manchester actually, in Salford Quays, this is Media City. In 2010, quite a large chunk of the BBC relocated up to the north. The reason for that was partly cost-saving initiative, obviously, but importantly, it was about distributing our presence up around the country so that it wasn't just this London-centric organisation. And it's proved very successful in that respect. And yeah, so this is Media City UK. It's a large campus. It has a much younger feel. The children's products are up there, sports up there, BBC Breakfast, Match of the Day. It's a really exciting place, but in a different way. This is inside Key House. Wow, big building. And then up in Scotland, in Glasgow, is my favourite BBC building. This is Pacific Quay. It's right on the Clyde. And it's my favourite building because it's really ambient and tranquil and peaceful. Each of these, architecturally, it's really interesting as well. And underneath each of these platforms that's leading up to the canteen at the top of the building there at the back, our different TV studios, so it's really functionally designed, it's really interesting. And this is my favourite place to work. The reason that I work in these different places is because my team's distributed around the country in the different locations. So there you go, there's just a quick snapshot of the place that I work. So creativity is at the heart of everything that the BBC does, and for the past almost 100 years, it's how we've informed, educated and entertained. During that time, as you might imagine, we've had to reinvent ourselves a number of times, and we've done this successfully by embracing design and technology. Since 1945, the BBC has been publicly funded with a licence fee. Everybody in the UK has a television, pays a licence fee, and for that amount of money, you get a lot of services. You get loads of TV, and we get radio, and we get all of this now, this online content. And it's great. The one thing that the one thing that we have to sort of be careful of and be aware of is that we're under a lot of pressure all the time to sort of change to become. There are a lot of our competitors in the sort of digital media market that would much prefer to see us become a subscription model potentially, like Netflix or Amazon. But we don't want that. We don't want that because we know from extensive research that our audiences don't want that. They're quite happy with what they get for that amount of money. We also don't want it because that's not what the BBC was set up to be. It was meant to be a public service funded by everybody, for everybody. But what our audiences do want is for us to remain a vital and relevant public service moving forward in the digital age. So the one thing that we always know at the BBC and can bank on is change. Change is our only constant. It's the one thing that is inevitable and is happening all the time. Now more than ever, as we change from being this traditional broadcaster to becoming an internet-fit organisation. So the great thing about changing into an internet-fit organisation is that you have the internet to be able to help you do this, and it gives you loads of great ways of serving all of our services in different ways and more exciting sort of ways in people's pockets and more personalised services. But it gives us something of a paradoxical requirement. and that is to provide greater efficiency while supporting an explosion of creative ambition. So we have to basically do a lot more and transform, but with a flatlining funding model. Since 2010, that licence fee has been locked at about £145, and it's not likely to go up anytime soon. So to do that, you need good strategy, right? But as a famous business commentator once said, culture eats strategy for breakfast. And that's really true, isn't it? Culture, the way that we work, the rhythms that we get into to deliver the things that we do. It's difficult to break those habits because they get ingrained. It's very difficult for any organisation, large or small, to down tools, step back, look at the way it works, rethink it and start again together. And for an organisation as large as the BBC, that's a luxury that we just don't have. So what happens is we make incremental steps towards change. And when you're really busy, that feels like this. Now, I'm sure you've probably all experienced that in your own ways, in your own worlds. It's not the best way of doing things, but it's often the way that they get done. So I work in a department of the BBC called BBC User Experience and Design. We are made up predominantly of UX designers, but also information architects, design researchers, and accessibility specialists. And it's a really talented group of people, and I'm very proud to work with them. We're a comparatively small department of the BBC, about 120 people. And that sits within a wider division of the BBC called Design and Engineering, about 1,300 people. And that sits within the rest of the BBC, which is, well, 20,000 people in the UK. Now imagine all of those 20,000, well, not all of them, but a great deal of that 20,000 are producing all of this fantastic content that all has to go through the sort of the digital funnel, if you like, of the design and engineering department, division, and then out through the window of interaction that our department create. Just 120 people, so the pressure's on. I'll give you an idea of how we're sort of structured. So here's just six of our products: news, weather, sport, iPlayer, radio, music, and children's products. Each of those products or services employs its own people. They employ their own engineers, their own business analysts, their own technical architects, their own editorial teams, and they have their own targets. What they don't have is designers. Our department has the designers. And we sort of sit centrally to all of those products, kind of like an agency. And we embed our teams into each of the products to fulfill their UX requirement. And then every 18 months or so, we rotate those designers into a different product. Now, that's great for their professional development because it allows them to step back and look at the, think about the bigger picture. But more importantly, well, just as importantly, it stops them from going native, as we call it. You know, because they get consumed by the culture of those products. Culture, again. It's palpable. You see, a designer will go and work in news for a year, and they'll emerge later, really very serious people. Let's get things done, deliver people. We've got to get on this now. And then you see another designer come out of working in the children's product for a year, and they're wearing colourful jumpers, and they're like, hey, we can do anything, guys. It really, I mean, I'm exaggerating, but I'm kind of not. It's very true that the culture in these products is very intense, and you pick it up. So that's what we're working with in the world that we're working in. It's based on the legacy, the way that we've been structured and built over the years. So each of our services are across different platforms that we do, loads of stuff. It's all that we design them using our global experience language, of which I'm the creative director. This is our shared design framework, which helps us to design both practically and philosophically. It's the consistent use of typography, of iconography, of the grid, of popular interaction patterns. And it's great because it provides that consistency provides the sort of familiarity that our users need to be able to travel around the BBC online more confidently. I'm sure you're all aware of that. You work in UX after all, right? This stuff is really important. Prior to this, it was a bit of a chaos, to be honest. In 2010, GEL was introduced, and it really brought some order to our online estate. Now, the BBC Online is essentially bbc.co.uk. It's under one URL, isn't it? But in reality, they're all just different websites and services, all kind of bolted together under that umbrella. So GEL brings about that consistency for our audiences. What my team do specifically, and we're spread across the different locations, is we facilitate, collect, and publish all of the great work that our designers embedded in the products do, and we strip them back and publish their design patterns as guidelines, reusable guidelines. So this becomes our sort of toolkit. We publish them on our websites that are available to everybody. The website is bbc.co.uk/gel. Show of hands, anybody that's seen this website? Okay, great. If you haven't, go and take a look. There's loads of great stuff on there. So we've kind of got our own publishing platform now. This site acts as both a toolkit for our designers to work more efficiently and consistently and together, and they can develop the language together collectively, which is fantastic. But it also acts as a sort of a showcase for the fantastic work that our designers do to the wider industry, to people like yourselves. But actually showing it to our designers in the BBC, the great work that they do, really helps them feel proud of the work they do, because you might all experience this when you work when you're in your everyday work, you kind of live in a bit of a bubble and you forget. And sometimes you need to frame the work you've done like a designer would with their portfolio. And they go, hang on, I did that, didn't I? And feel good about it. And the website acts like that. Our designers can publish articles, they can write guidelines and contribute to this ever-evolving language. All languages evolve over time, don't they? So does ours. You can also make films, write cool articles and things. And on that subject, I've got a bit of an exclusive for you. On our website, we have a number of like really fun explainer films that help sort of tell the story of the work that we do in a slightly less dry way. And I've got a brand new film that's just about to be published next week, so nobody has seen this. I've just taken delivery of it. And it's about our human-centered design research practice. It's only 3 minutes long. Check it out.
Humans, a complicated species, and their relationship with technology an even more complicated one. How does one design for such a complex, contradictory species? It's simple. You observe them. Embrace your inner anthropologist. Whilst it's important to monitor your fellow humans' behavior covertly, it is imperative to interact. Ask questions.
Hi, do you have time to talk about your favorite skeuomorphic icon? Do you have time to talk about your favorite call to action? Do you have time to talk about your favorite font?
Don't be afraid to venture into their nests. Witness their peculiar habits firsthand.
What's the first thing you look at in the morning?
Kittens. Sometimes capybaras.
Fascinating.
You must be willing to push boundaries with challenging, abstract, philosophical research.
Okay, imagine this inflatable house is the internet. Where do you go for the latest news? Go!
Endeavour to unearth the roots of human behaviour. There are no right or wrong answers. In fact, there are no answers at all. Only insight, experience, and inspiration.
News.
Be brave.
Tell me what you're thinking, Michael.
Release your prototyplings into the world early.
It's just a prototype. It won't hurt my feelings.
When I press the button, it doesn't feel like I'm pressing a button.
And why do you think that is?
I don't know.
Alas, your newly acquired knowledge means nothing if you can't use it to make change. To learn, evolve. And to do that, you must share your own findings with your flock. Swarm on the problem together. And so they tentatively, bravely release the fruits of their labour into the wild. For the vast majority, these changes go unnoticed. For others, they make all the difference. And so the cycle begins again. Humans have always been complex creatures and always will be. Some behaviors are harder to understand than others. But that shouldn't stop you from trying.
It's funny, right? It's good. Thank you. That's nice. Did anybody recognize the voiceover? It's Robert Winston, Professor Robert Winston. That was a bit of a scoop getting him. We had to... Anyway, it's great. I love this film. We're really pleased with it. And it's typical of the kind of films that we make, just doing it in a playful way. And playfulness is really important in the world that we work in, I believe. I'm sure you'll have heard that said before. So, Gel is doing well. It's brought about this order, and it's a successful design framework which we work with and is going well. But it starts... If that's the case, if... it's been successful, then it starts to raise the question around the idea of guidelines. So guidelines are providing consistency, but in a changing world. All of our services are built on different technical stacks, by different teams, as I mentioned before, the different product teams. And they're all built, and the code that they're built with is squirreled away in different repositories, and it's invisible to other teams, so nothing can be reused. So there's this vast amount of duplication of effort. So we're racking up this technical debt, and this isn't an efficient way of working. So essentially what Gel does is it makes things look the same. They're all kind of built differently, but they look the same. Well, we believe that if we're to be, you know, a truly flexible and digital organization moving forward, that we should flip that. Instead of things being built differently and looking the same, we think they should be built the same to enable them to look different. But we face the culture that I've mentioned before. That's troublesome, isn't it? Because we can't do that without the help of our wider colleagues that are employed in each of the different siloed products. So how might we do this? How might we prove the benefits of not making not only reusable design patterns, but also reusable code? How might we bring designers and technology and engineering people closer together, so speaking the same sort of language? And importantly, how might we give them, our wider colleagues, that same sense of ownership of this thinking? Because if you get that bit right, then strategy has a fighting chance. Well, one thing that we've done in our UX team is that we've built an extra section to the Gel website, which is a component library, an online component library, where a coalition of willing developers around the organization can contribute the different components that they make by submitting a manifest file, and then it appears in this list. It displays it in an iframe, so you can see its nature, you can see it in action. We can apply quality testing to it, look at accessibility, check how it's doing. And it's visible to all the other engineering teams. So suddenly we're upping that opportunity for reuse of code. Now we're doing this at a grassroots level. We're encouraging this to happen. We're showing that the way that we work with Gel has been successful for us. Why couldn't it work at a larger level? Now you could argue, why aren't you just getting this done from top down, it being a way that the organization should just work and just be enforced? Well, we've tried that in the past and it just didn't work. Remember, we're 20,000 people. There's a lot of people at the BBC, and they all have different ways of working, and it's difficult to enforce something. It's better if people own it and do it for themselves. So this component library is a start down the right route. We believe that if you want to evolve culture, if you want to evolve, the best way of doing that is by natural selection. So over time, you'll start to see the best code being reused and rising to the surface, and the not-as-good code sort of dropping away. There's something about language as well that I think you should that we should all consider, whether you're in a small agency or a large organization. You know, there's something about language. It can be inhibitive. It can be troublesome. It can keep people divided to a certain respect. So we talk about, you'll have heard me say, products. What they actually are services. A service can be owned and maintained by many. And instead of teams is traditionally considered a great word, team, yeah? But actually, you know, let's think about our different product teams as being communities, because you can move around a lot more easily in a community and up the opportunity for collaboration. So I'm not saying that we go around the organisation saying, instead of saying products, say services. We're not doing that. It's just illustrating the idea of how we speak and the jargon and the vocabulary that we all use every day actually might be part of the problem. So that's another thing that we think about. So by doing this, we're hoping to bring, to live up to our name as a division a bit better, bring design and engineering closer together. And by making these sort of steps, we feel that we've reached base camp and we're ready to take on that mountain of culture one step at a time. And by doing that right, we can be even better at informing, educating, and entertaining, like this.
Story time.
Story time with Gabriel is
silly. I want stories because they make me happy.
Yeah.
Yeah, me too. Yeah.
Some of the words sometimes I find challenging.
Difficult dinosaur names.
Story time.
Which one?
Somi.
The new interactive CBBS Storytime app, full of big stories for little fingers.
Thank you, baby.
Free to download now.
I have been searching all of my days. Any road, you know, I've been walking on.
BBC iPlayer. Now on mobile, tablet, TV, and games consoles. So you can watch your favourite BBC programmes wherever and whenever you want to.
People are different. Some of us want the day's top stories, while some of us are fascinated by world news or by what's happening on our doorstep. For some, it's business. For others, it's Beyonce, or tennis, or technology. That's why, with the BBC News app, you can choose the news you want to follow, all at your fingertips. For the news that matters to you, download the new BBC News app.
Thank you very much.